Well, good evening. Welcome to the regular council meeting on Monday, April 27th, 2015. I have with me this evening my council colleagues, Councillor Jack Arnold, Councillor Paul Albrecht, Councillor Rudy Storterbroom. I'm Mayor Ted Schaefer. I have Councillor Gail Martin, and Val Vandenbroek didn't make it tonight. She is away, and Councillor Dave Hall is here this evening. From the staff, we have Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services, and Graham Flack, I believe, is in the audience as well, who is the Deputy Director of Corporate Services. Carolyn Machado, Manager of Legislative Services. Francis Chung, our CAO. We have Mr. Roy Beto, Deputy Director of Development Services and Economic Development. Rick Baumhoff, Director of Engineering, Parks and Environment. Rory Thompson, our Fire Chief. And Kim Hilton, our Director of Recreation, Culture and Community Services. And I have a motion that the agenda for April 27th, 2015 regular meeting be adopted as amended, deleting item 5B from the agenda and moving item 7A to follow the delegations portion of the meeting. Councillor Storterboom, Councillor Arnold, any discussion? All those in favor? Councillor, unanimous. Minutes of the last meeting, that the minutes of the regular meeting held on April 13th, 2015 be adopted as circulated. Need a mover? Councillor Storterboom, Councillor Albrecht. All those in favor? It's unanimous four. The delegations. Local Government Awareness Day recognition. And it's quite something. Councillor Storterboom, I'll let you take care of this one.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Local Government Day in the City of Langley was a bit different this year. As you know, the city is in the process of building a new $14 million project to rebuild our Thames Community Center, retrofit our Fraser Valley Regional Library, and incorporate these into an updated City Hall complex. This event is always fun and educational for our community's grade 5 students, but because of the construction, Local Government Day 2015 was relocated to our Douglas Recreation Center this year. Next year, we plan to be at our new Civic Center and look forward to showing off our brand new facility. Local Government Day 2015 was certainly a big hit. Even the weather worked out for us. Deputy Corporate Officer Paula Cusack did an amazing job in organizing the big event with crews, teachers, parents, volunteers, tour guides, and City Council representatives. This year we had 205 students attend Local Government Day from our Langley City Schools to become familiar with the city's different departments and some of our interesting equipment. The students really seemed to enjoy meeting the firefighters, seeing the fire truck, police cars, loaders, and diggers, and I thought the sewer camera was pretty cool. Many thanks to all participants, including Councillor Gail Martin, my Vice Chair and School Board Trustees Rosemary Wallace and Shelley Coburn, as well as special volunteers and assorted committee members who acted as guides to tour stations representing our various departments, and including recreation, emergency services, works. Even ICBC brought us a crashed car to remind us that drinking and driving do not go together. With sponsorship from Fortis BC and our local McDonald's restaurant, students were invited to participate in a do's and don'ts natural gas and electricity safety contest. The winner was a young lady named Madison Starnes from Simons Elementary School. Madison's class will be treated to a lunch from McDonald's restaurants delivered by our mayor, Ted Schaefer, and myself. Madison is here today to be recognized as our contest winner for the banner that she created. I'm sure that Madison's parents, classroom teacher Ms. Mandel, and Madison's classmates are all very proud of Madison and the banner that she made. Also, Fortis BC is providing 8 gift certificates for 8 teachers who attended Local Government Day with their students as public thanks and recognition for their contribution to this event. At this time, I would like to ask Madison Starnes from Simons Elementary School in Langley City to join myself at the microphone with Amanda Signo, our local McDonald's restaurant coordinator, manager, and Joan Isaac from Fortis BC to be recognized by City Council for their contributions to Local Government Day 2015. at the mic, if you please.
So it's Amanda Digno from McDonald's and Joan Isaac from Fortis. Wow.
Congratulations, Madison, and thank you to Fortis BC and McDonald's Restaurant at 216th and the Fraser Highway for making Local Government Day 2015 a time to enjoy and remember. Fortis and McDonald's Restaurants are ongoing and greatly appreciated corporate partners to this terrific event and in providing quality service and generous consideration to the residents of Langley City. I look forward to partnering with Fortis and McDonald's Restaurants again in the future. And a big shout out to Robin McMahon of McDonald's, Amy Hennessy of Fortis BC, and Gord Schoberg as well. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to our corporate sponsors and to Madison and to the school, and we'll see you in a couple days. The next item we have is ex-counselor, past counselor, Terry James, who is the executive director of the Downtown Langley Business Association, and she's going to be talking up McBurney Plaza Summer Family Series, and we have this wonderful poster in front of us here, and we're looking forward to some excitement down there.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Just going to get set up here. Slideshow. Never had to work it from this end before, so thank you everyone for having us here this evening. Mayor and Council, members of staff, viewing audience, members of the media, and anybody watching from home, we're here this evening to share with you the plans for what we are very pleased to call the 2015 McBurney Plaza Summer Series. Before I go much further, I'd like to introduce two of my directors, Heather Jenkins from One Fish, Two Fish Fresh Seafood Market, and Tanya Gabera from Gateway Casinos, Cascades Casino Resort. So thank you, ladies, for being here. They're my two new favorites now.
How quick we forget.
Right? I'm easily swayed. So what you have in front of you is the official graphic and poster for the McBurney Plaza Summer Series for this year. So I'm just going to provide a little bit of background information for those who may not know how this sort of came about. So we've proudly named it the City of Langley and the Downtown Langley Business Association's 2015 McBurney Plaza Summer Series. A little bit of background information. Last year, the city applied for and were the successful recipients of the Open for Business Award with the province of BC. And they earmarked the potential $10,000 for downtown activities and festivals. And then, of course, they won it. So that was very exciting. So seeing the potential for McBurney Plaza programming, the DLBA asked the city to consider matching up to $20,000 to accomplish this. Throughout the budget process earlier this year, an additional $10,000 was approved by Mayor and Council. Thank you for that, and I'm sure you'll be pleased with the results. And then it was matched by the DLBA for a total programming budget of $40,000. The City of Langley has entrusted this programming to be overseen by us, and voila, this was born. So some of the highlights, just to, before I delve into the actual series themselves, we're very pleased to give top billing to the city in recognition, both by their, for their tremendous support, but both via the text on the top, and you'll see the place logos on the bottom as well. We took a photo of McBurney Plaza as the starting point for the graphic marketing and transformed it into the visual that clearly shows that this is McBurney Plaza for anybody who looks at it. The series will be presented and advertised as a series, and I'll explain that in a little more detail in a minute. Each event brings a new and fresh idea to the plaza, as though they're individual events, but they're also, like I say, being run as a series. We're integrating them with existing downtown events for a total of 9 free family-oriented events happening between June 13th and September 26th this year. We have engaged business involvement whenever possible and whenever the businesses are willing. We have a very strong marketing campaign in place to properly promote this to the public, and I do want to say that that will start immediately. We wanted Mayor and Council to see this first before we went live with it, so hope you all like it because it's going live tomorrow. As each event passes, it won't be removed from the existing advertising, but it'll have a nice message across it to invite the community to attend the next one. Now, this is literally hot off the presses, the poster you have, but the other advertising materials will be ready tomorrow. So it will say, you know, come to the next event, or thank you for coming, or something very nice like that, so that everybody can see that it's not one-offs, that it's actually a series of 5 being done, and that there's much more to come. And again, all the events are absolutely free to the public, and we feel we've got a nice cross-section that will offer something for absolutely everybody. So, without further delay, I'll delve into the events themselves. So what I've got on the slides in front of you is the actual editorial, I guess you want to call it, that we're sharing with the public to engage them and get some interest. But I'm more than willing to answer any questions you might have at the end of this presentation if you want to delve into some more particulars. So, without belaboring it too much, I'm just going to read it. So the first one is Build It in the Plaza on Saturday, June 13th. Now, before I go much further, all the events are from noon to 3. The reason that we decided to do this was when we looked at the budget, we considered travel time for the entertainment and what we could possibly put together for a first attempt this year. We want 3 hours of action-packed activities for the community when they come. There'll be no downtime. There'll be something going on continuously through each event. So we felt that 3 hours was a good amount of time for a first effort. So there won't be any like boring spots or anything like that. So Build It in the Plaza. What we're planning on doing is decking out McBurney Plaza in all kinds of things, DIY gardening in particular. There'll be displays, vertical gardening, planters, there'll be opportunities for kids to build it. So the days are getting warmer, and this is the perfect time to start your outdoor landscaping and building projects. If you're looking for inspiration, you've found it. Join local gardening celebrity Shelley Levy of Sowindipity as she provides live demonstrations for DIY projects such as creating an edible window box and upcycling to a beautiful garden. She's a speaker, writer, garden decorator, theme designer, and self-described craftanista. In between demonstrations, visit inspiring DIY displays showcasing vertical gardening, backyard beautification, and more. And young do-it-yourselfers are invited to come build a toolbox or a birdhouse on site with the help from Don Cole Nature Products, or visit building sensory stations for hands-on fun. So all of these events, this, what is in front of you or on the screen there, is actually what's planned. It can only get better. There's still planning in behind the scenes, and there's more to come. So what I'm showing you is what we have absolutely confirmed. So at the very least, you'll be getting what you see in front of you. So that's our first event, followed by, on Saturday, June 27th, Theater in the Plaza. McBurney Plaza will transform into another world with a little help from your imagination and some special guests. To ensure you're stage ready, visit the face painting and costume station, then participate in fun group acting lessons and perfect your performance skills. Once you're in character, enjoy regularly scheduled interactive family-friendly performances by play, and that's professional live arts for youth. Build your own puppet on site or bring a puppet from home and enjoy the special improv shows. With so many exciting activities, you'll want to be here from casting call to curtain call, and the Barden of Valley folks confirmed today, actually, that they are coming to share the fun and show us a little bit of what's in store for this July in Douglas Park with their production of Love's Labour's Lost by William Shakespeare. So that's the second. The third one we've planned is Art in the Plaza on Saturday, July 25th. Art is thriving and can be found almost everywhere you look in downtown Langley. Visit McBurney Plaza, where local painters, sculptors, carvers, and more will be sharing their creative process as they work on site. Watch how Patricia Burnett from Funky Cool Patina creates her amazing retro pieces right before your eyes. Try your hand at your very own masterpiece during an art lesson in the plaza, and take home your work of art for proud to display proudly. For the little artist in your family, pick up your free canvas board from Opus Art and Framing starting on June 27th, and return your artwork by July 20th, and you'll see your art displayed at the event in a professionally curated gallery. Bring your inner artist, no experience required. And then we have animals in the plaza. Do you love things that crawl, slither, hop, and climb? Or maybe you prefer the more cuddly four-legged friends? Come join fellow animal lovers in McBurney Plaza for a fun-filled day of animal education. We're bringing in the Urban Safari Rescue Society. They'll be on site showcasing rehabilitated animals through educational presentations. They're an organization that rescues and cares for exotic animals that are surrendered to them and help educate the public about conservation issues. Learn how we can help keep our environment and waterways safe for animals to thrive in. There'll be tips and tricks shared by expert dog trainers, and we'll also have a dog agility demonstration that's not to be missed. There'll be fun and fabulous animal crafts, stories, and more. So as you can see as I go along, these are very family-oriented. There's something for absolutely everybody. Last but definitely not least, circus in the plaza. Follow your nose to the smell of fresh popcorn and cotton candy. The circus is coming to town. Join special guests from the Inner Ring Circus as they bring their amazing talents to our very own McBurney Plaza. Keep your eyes open for stilt walkers, jugglers, unicycles, and more. Learn to juggle, plate spin, or master the flower sticks. Play a carnival game or two, and then say hello to Scruffles the Clown as he stops by to entertain with his spectacular balloon art creations. The Inner Ring Circus is a professional entertainment company specializing in the production of innovative circus arts. They inspire, develop, and produce custom entertainment designed to exhilarate and inspire, and they're unparalleled in their ability to excite everyone's imagination. And then from 12:30 to 2:30, Cloud9 Cotton Candy will be on site, and they bring gourmet, all-natural, organic cotton candy in their adorable old vintage cart, and they're going to be bringing six flavors of fun. So that, as I mentioned, is the series of five that we're planning. Everything that I've talked about is written in stone, and we continue to think of unique opportunities to bring to these events as well. But this is the information that's being released to the public tomorrow. So a little bit of background on the marketing. We really wanted to create a brand. It has its own acronym now too. It's MPSS, just so you're in the know. Create a brand for these events that will carry us to the future years as we continue a partnership with the City of Langley. We have gone ahead and changed our homepage to pop the importance of the events, and that's what you see in the graphic to your right. To ensure there's dedicated web pages to substantiate each event and support these series, with a well-thought-out marketing strategy, including leveraging 9 downtown events to take advantage of the best advertising opportunities possible. So it was a lot easier for me to go into negotiations with all of the advertising organizations when I had 9 events on the table to organize, or to talk to them about, the series of 5, and then the additional ones that the DLBA puts on. So that always helps a lot. We've made our substantial website changes that go into effect tomorrow. We secured the URL www.mcburneyplaza.com. We thought that was a smart move going forward, just to make sure that we had that when we needed it. And these, of course, are all available for the city's use as well. Any marketing materials or anything that we've secured as an organization are absolutely welcome for the city to use. There'll be advertising in Stimuli Magazine, the Langley Times, the Langley Advance, local and Fraser Valley bloggers, social media, and 6 transit posters placed very carefully in strategic locations throughout the Langleys. We've partnered with every media avenue, and they've either agreed to match or discount their advertising fees for us. We're creating postcards with all of the events that are happening to be distributed at every event. So this means after the June 13th event, we'll still have an additional 8 opportunities and different events to make sure that people know that there's something always happening in this little community, and that's exactly what we're trying to accomplish here. And again, engaging BIA businesses to be involved whenever possible. Definitely not the least, but last slide I have for you this evening before I make some thank yous is the details of the budget. So with a $40,000 budget, you can see in front of you, I've taken the liberty of kind of that flowery bullet there, broken down where the marketing and advertising $11,000 is going to be spent. Now this is for all 5 events. The entertainment is $10,000. That's what we've budgeted for. I'll talk a little bit about contingency at the end of this, but it's not just the main performers. There's also, we're going to ensure that there's face painters and balloon twisters and crafts for the kids and stuff on site as well. So it's not just just for the main entertainers, but as you can appreciate, when you're bringing in this level of quality and professionalism, there's a cost associated. The planning fees, working with Rare Affairs Event Planning, I'm involved absolutely every step of the way. These people are worth their weight in gold. They are the ones that are actually outsourcing the entertainment and hooking things up, and in conjunction with discussions with me and working on the marketing, it's coming together beautifully. This is not something that I could ever hope to do off the side of my desk as a two-person office, so I am grateful to them for this. The design, which is what you see in front of you, but also resizing for all the advertising, creation of transit posters, website changes, things like that. So that was $3,000. To have a professional audiovisual MC in attendance at all the events is $3,000. I don't know about you guys, but there's nothing that I dislike more than going somewhere and nobody's running the show. And in this event, we've hired a professional MC to make sure that people continue to remain engaged and know what's going on and what's available to do for the 3 hours. The logistics, which is we plan on decorating the plaza for each and every event distinct to that event that's taking place. That includes 20 by 20s, 10 by 10s, chairs for people to sit on, balloons, plants, whatever we decide at the time that we need to make McBurney Plaza transform to fit with the theme of whatever event's taking place. Staffing is $2,000 for all 5 events, and again, I think that's essential because these will be people who are actually trained and know what's happening and will be able to help people and tell them what's going on and direct them throughout the course of the events. And then our contingency, and as Mayor and Council can attest to, no good plan is without a contingency, but I can assure you that if this isn't spent for an unforeseen, that we plan on using the $1,000 to give away free downtown dollars to people that attend the events throughout the day. So it will be put to good use, whether it's in the form of downtown dollars or if we actually do need it as a contingency. So I'm sure there will be a few questions. I do want to say a couple of thank yous before I move on to that opportunity. Genuine and from my heart and in no particular order, on behalf of myself and my board of directors, Rare Affairs Meeting and Event Planning, these people, I've worked with them for 2 years now on several events, and they saw the vision for McBurney Plaza before it was even revitalized. They live and work down here. They absolutely get what we're trying to do. They've been partners every step of the way, not only in the planning, but they are the ones that are coming to the table genuinely with the resources and the connections for things like circus in the plaza and animals in the plaza and things like that. Like these people come with a wealth of knowledge, and I'm very appreciative of them. Vanessa Renee from Renee Creative, she's the one that took the photo of McBurney Plaza and transformed it into the graphic that you see, which I personally think is quite creative and brilliant, actually. She's been working with me for years and years as well, so she's been part of the DLBA branding from day one, and she truly gets the vision that I think that we're trying to accomplish here. And because of our professional relationship over the years, we have a good synergy, and I can honestly say she's worth her weight in gold, and she has done the designing for considerably less than another designer would have been willing to do it for. The Langley Advance came to the table with arms open as usual, and they have offered 100% matching dollars for all our print and web advertising that we do with them. Of course, my board of directors, no idea is too big or small or crazy, and every time I get around the table with these people, we don't always agree, but there's a really good energy, and I think the end results speak for themselves. They are very, very supportive, and I am very grateful to them. And last but definitely not least, the City of Langley, Mayor and Council. Cities don't exist without strong partnerships. I can honestly say I'm the person that goes to the BIABC conferences, and I hear people in my role in other communities complaining about their board or complaining about their mayor and council or complaining about their municipality, not always, but often. And I'm one of the people who is pleased and proud to be able to sit in the room and say nothing because it's all good. The partnerships exist, the support is there, the ideas continue to flow, and we couldn't be more appreciative of the ongoing partnership that we feel that we have with the City of Langley. So that is it for my presentation, and I would be delighted to answer any questions or hear feedback.
Questions? Councillor Martin.
Well, thanks very much, Terry. I think it's going to be a real exciting summer, and the poster, it just is just so, and it looks like fun.
Yeah.
So it's going to be great. you may have said this at the beginning of your presentation, in regards to like the build it and the art and stuff, is this absolutely free, or if they want to build something, do they have to buy supplies, or they want to do the art thing, do they have to buy supplies?
Excellent question. So everything is absolutely free with the exception of the birdhouses and toolboxes at the build it, and that gentleman comes free of charge, and I think the birdhouse kit is like $4 or something, so it's a very modest cost.
Right. Okay.
But everything else we've managed to put together either through partnerships, sponsorships, or within the budget. So the art with Opus is a true partnership with them. Like, we're buying the canvases at cost, but they're acting as our distribution point,
right,
and they're going to be the funnel for the information for the community and stuff like that, which makes sense. Like, they're open 9 to 5 Monday through Sunday. So yeah, that's in answer to your question. That's the only one that there'll be a small cost associated. And we're still trying to work out if we can maybe potentially find one more partnership where we can actually buy the birdhouses.
Right. No, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
And what about the cotton candy guy? Is he going to be, is there going to be a charge for the kids for that?
We're going to be handing out one free ticket to
right,
the best of our ability. I'm
oh,
sure
that's
there'll be
wonderful,
some cheaters. But we're going to hand out one free ticket to everyone in attendance so that they can get a sample.
Yep.
And then if they want to purchase, then
they can.
They're able to. Yeah.
Great. Well, congratulations to you and your board. I mean, I think this is a perfect place. McBurney is a fantastic venue, and it's really going to liven up the downtown and bring people down. So congratulations again.
Thanks, Councillor Martin. We're very excited about it.
Councillor Albrecht and Councillor Arnold.
Yeah, thank you, Terry. A very, very impressive presentation you made here. You and your group are incredibly prepared, and I'm just blown away by it. It's truly
that was the idea.
Truly special. I completely support this, and I'm really looking forward to it. Very excited to see it succeed. I know it will. There's no doubt in my mind. So with the team that you've assembled, it's going to be great. My question I had was rain or shine, are there plan Bs? It doesn't really matter. I can't see anything dampening the spirit of this.
Well, thank you for your question, Councillor Albrecht. Yes, it's rain or shine, and having been in this role for 15 years, I've done it all, and I can tell you, as we have on Community Day and things like that, I can tell you that if the public's engaged and it's something for the family, they will come, rain or shine. So we're fully prepared with the 20 by 20s and things like that. That's where the logistics budget comes in, because we're going to assemble those and have them available to the public, rain or shine, just in that event. So thanks for your question.
Yeah, so thank you for everything that you and your group does in the community.
Thank you.
Councillor Arnold.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Two things. One really doesn't have to do with this, but it's good that you're here, Terry, because I happened to run into our first baby born in BC again today, and he was with his mom and his grandparents, and there was just they're still bubbling, and they couldn't stop talking about the support they received from council and in particular from the Downtown Merchants Association. So they said if I ran into you to make sure I said thank you again.
Thank you.
Now on this, on the animals in the plaza, because there's, I would assume that these animals are not going to be running loose.
No.
But I guess my question is, I don't imagine people are going to be bringing other sorts of pets, but are people allowed to bring their dogs along to this?
All of these events are dog friendly. Absolutely. We'll have appropriate bags and things like that on hand, and water bowls and stuff like that. The animals, I've actually been to this particular organization, their displays before, and they're all very carefully contained. It's actually almost like set apart, and they have fencing. The kids come in, so if they want to touch the creepy crawlies and stuff, they do it within the area that's very well monitored. So absolutely, these events are pet friendly for
okay,
sure.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Councillor Storterboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Hi, Terry.
Hi, Rudy.
You are an entrepreneur and event coordinator extraordinaire.
I just know really good people.
I can't thank you enough. I think you're awesome. This is exactly what McBurney's is meant for, and you get it. And it's no surprise to me that someone of your caliber draws those qualified people to you to be able to put on events like this for the betterment of the citizens and residents of the city of Langley.
Thank you.
Can't thank you enough. You get it, and you go with it, and I miss having you on council.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Councillor Hall.
Thank you. I very much like the graphics. And
great.
I'd like you to pass on
we
to
love
The artists. They're a work of art themselves. The question I have, sometimes when we run events, some of the merchants, just on the fringes of the event, suggest that perhaps it interferes. And people right there, sometimes they're blocked off. So what will you be doing, or what will the merchants be doing to attract the spillover, to have this as an advantage to them rather than something that they see as discourages business?
That's a really good question, Councillor Hall. Thank you. And in my experience, this is something that we're always going to continuously run into, is the ones who don't see having hundreds or even thousands of people in your downtown as an opportunity. So we have a very strong, I guess, awareness campaign built around this that not only includes the marketing to the public that I explained, but the marketing to the businesses as well. And honestly, they're given every opportunity. So part of the idea behind having a three-hour event is we had a long discussion that 3 hours is enough for people to be entertained, and then there's still some hope after that or before or whatever, that there's some time left in their family gas tanks where they actually do take a walk around and explore. A lot of the anchor businesses or seasoned businesses, if you will, in the downtown recognize that they might not have astonishing sales that day, but awareness is every bit as important as the actual sales. So they will be well armed and well informed, and if they choose not to participate or gripe, well, that's what they're going to do. So thank you.
Well, Terry, you're an incredible event coordinator. You do a great job for the downtown and for the city of Langley. Don't sell yourself short. You're always giving accolades to everybody else but yourself, but you know, you're doing a great job. Your board's doing a great job, and not only do you just promote the downtown, but you promote the city and the region as well, which goes a long way. We all live in this community. And to touch on what my council colleague chatted about earlier, the animals, I'll be looking forward to going to One Fish to take a look at the live lobster and the sleeping halibut that
Absolutely.
They have there. Yeah.
And the little fish.
Yeah, the little fishies there. Yeah, they're all sleeping.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate you guys listening and catching the same wave of enthusiasm that we are experiencing right now, because it was a lot of planning, it was a lot of discussions, and seeing it come to fruition is genuinely exciting. Like, we really think this is going to be something special for our plaza. So thank you very much for having me this evening.
Thank you. And there it is, McBurney Plaza. So
there it is. Oh yeah, and you're supposed to take those posters and hang it in your foyer, your favorite store, or that's the idea.
Let's see if I can get a couple of my friends to put a few up.
Exactly. And I have about 300 more. Just
300 more.
Yeah. Never short on supplies.
Well, thank you
very
for coming.
Much. You bet.
Well, the next item we have today is Mr. Bill Cox from BDO Dunwoody, and he's going to give an audit report. And I'd like to now invite him up there to the mic and first ask Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services, to do the introductions and the info.
Thank you, Mayor Schaefer, members of council. Before you is the draft of financial statements for the year ended December 31st, 2014. I'm going to make a few brief comments and then answer any questions you may have, and then introduce our auditor later on. On page 54 of your council agenda, the financial statements actually outline what the city management's responsibilities are to prepare the consolidated financial statements and to ensure the accounting procedures and systems of internal control are in place in order to safeguard the city's assets. The auditors examine the financial statements, and with us, as I mentioned earlier, or you mentioned, is Mr. Bill Cox from BDO Dunwoody, BDO Canada LLP. And he will speak briefly about his audit report shortly. On page 56 of the financial statements, or in your agenda package on page 56, is the statement of financial position. You'll see that the city has a positive net financial asset position of $37.1 million. This is actually a decrease from the prior year, and it's primarily due to the reduction in the land held for resale, which is kind of like treat it like an inventory item. And the city sold a piece of property actually across the street in Langley Mall area, which is now the new Tim's Hortons restaurant, which resulted in a lowering of our net financial assets. As well, there were less receivables outstanding compared to the prior year, where a large receivable was outstanding in 2013 from the provincial government relating to the 204th Street project expropriation settlement. The focus on the statement of financial position is really the final line of the statement, and that is the accumulated surplus. We have an accumulated surplus of $255 million. The name of this could be a bit confusing for council. It definitely doesn't mean that council has the ability to go out and spend that money right now. It actually reflects our long-term tangible capital assets that the city has already invested in. It's more like our net worth for the city. Assets are a significant economic resource managed by the city and are a key component in the delivery of many of the services that we provide, like the distribution of water or sewage removal. Roads and buildings would also be included in that total. The assets increased by $9.6 million in 2014, less the $4.7 million in amortization expenses and disposal of assets like vehicles that were replaced. Over time, the accumulated surplus number is the one that we'll want to track. As the assets age, accumulated surplus will drop due to the amortization. The city will want to ensure that we maintain and replace our infrastructure assets. Going now to the next page, on page 57 of your agenda report, is the statement of financial activities. And this shows all the city's revenues and expenditures, which also includes our capital asset amortization. The overall operating deficit in 2014, which includes water, sewer, and general funds in the operating side, was $515,000. This is a deficit. To this we add the increase in tangible capital assets and the increase in the reserve balances that results in an overall surplus of $3.9 million. Focusing on that operating deficit is really the result of that land sale that we talked about, the $524,000. The land was held for resale, and as the cash proceeds are being transferred to reserves, it results in a deficit. So taking that and isolating that one item, the overall surplus was $9,000, which results from a higher revenue, lower expenditures, and other transfer to reserves. So we directed $466,000 to the Capital Works Reserve and a further $537,000 relating to the cash proceeds from that property sale. We had anticipated a larger operating surplus as part of our 2015 financial plan discussions that we had a couple months ago, but it ended up that it was more likely about $466,000 once the year-end adjustments are finalized and the internal equipment, rentals, etc., which are treated as an amortization expense, we ended up closer to that $466,000 as our operating surplus. In 2014, financial plan bylaw amendment is required later in the meeting to allow for the over expenditure in three areas: water services, garbage and recycling, as well as the larger transfer to reserves, as I noted earlier. Without going into too much more detail in the financial statements, that's what I wanted to draw your attention to tonight. I'll take this opportunity to thank Graham Flack in the audience and the rest of our corporate services team who make an extra effort during our audit time and completion of our year-end financial statements. Their efforts are really appreciated. And if you have any questions about the actual financial statements, I'd be happy to answer those now before we move on to our audit report.
Councillor Hall.
Okay, so we bandied around a whole bunch of numbers, but the one that you said that we should be tracking is this accumulated surplus of $255 million. Now, I understand that that involves some depreciation over time. So do we have a sense of what percentage of that accumulated surplus would depreciate and reduce, and what we need to replace? I guess what I'm looking for is what's the dollar comfort figure that we would have 5 years down the road for an accumulated surplus?
Right. So the accumulated surplus, as you said, is our total. Our depreciation or amortization in 2014 was $4.7 million. So that's what we want to make sure that we're at least covering our amortization, and that number is continuing to grow and expand over time. So that would be kind of the number that I would think that you're looking for.
Supplementary. So if we were not to reach that goal, when do the alarm bells sound? Like $255 million total seems like, you know, we're in pretty darn good shape. Right. If we were to fall to 200, would that mean we would have to find some other manner to replace or bump up our infrastructure levy or do something to make a correction? At what level are we trying to maintain this at?
So I think it's more of a trend that we're looking at, not really what level, because our financial plan or our budget for capital improvement plan really looks at what we're wanting to replace in the next 10 years, and that keys on infrastructure renewal or replacement of existing water pipes, existing sewer pipes, you know, redoing our roads, et cetera. So I think what I'm trying to draw your attention to on the financial statements, which is a historical look at the dollar cost of those items, is that we want to make sure it's trending the right way. And if it was trending the wrong way consistently, that's what would cause the alarm bells to be ringing. I don't think I can really say it in dollar terms, but it's really a trend.
Thank you.
Further questions? Seeing none?
Now, then I would like to turn it over to Mr. Bill Cox from BDO.
Great, thanks, Darren. I'm going to be very brief with my comments. As you know, we had the opportunity in a prior closed council meeting to go into some details in regard to the audit. So I think, and all those details were good, positive. So I'll just speak at a high level. The audit is virtually complete. There's a couple of last minute things that have to be done, but we are certain that it is going to be an unqualified audit opinion, otherwise known as a clean audit opinion. So that's the highest form of assurance that us as auditors can provide to the financial statements. So the financial statements are your staff responsibility. They prepared them. Darren explained the variances and highlights in the numbers. Our job is just to look at those numbers and make sure that they are fairly stated. And to do that, we had full access to all information that we asked for. We get a lot of manual accounting information. We get computerized information. Anything that we asked for, we had access to, and totally unfettered access to anything that we needed to. So we're very satisfied with the audit results. And we couldn't find too much to complain about. So it was a very clean audit, good audit results, and a clean audit opinion coming shortly.
Great. Questions at all? I have one for you. And being in City Hall quite a bit, I noticed that there was not just one or two auditors. I came into this room and there was four auditors, and they were in here for quite a few days. So an audit process just doesn't go on for a couple of days. Could you please explain to the viewing audience how long and approximately takes, et cetera?
Yes, I almost wish I had a PowerPoint for this. This would be exciting stuff. You're right, there is a lot to it. And I'll try not to be too long, but there's two components. There's something that we call an interim audit, which deals with systems and processes. That's very important. There's a great volume of transactions that go through the city, and it's much more efficient for an audit point of view. And of course, more efficient means less costly for the auditors to be able to rely on good control systems. So in the fall, we come out and our staff go through the systems and through your computer systems, make sure those are operating well and that they're reliable to work on. And we come back after the fiscal year end, and that's when you were in and saw our team of staff working on that. And what we do there is we follow up on those systems, make sure that the systems that were working well in the fall when we were out are still working out well now. And then we also get into testing of transactions. We don't look at every single transaction, otherwise we'd be here all year, which would be fine by me, but perhaps not by your staff. So we do testing of transactions, sort of statistical testing, very much like a Gallup poll sort of process where our actual opinion says we're 95% confident that the numbers are fairly stated, plus or minus what we call our audit materiality level, which is a fairness indicator. So at the end of the day, you're quite right, it's a lot of staff hours that go into it. Our end product is a one-page audit report, so it doesn't quite reflect all the work that goes into it, but there it's quite a thorough checking of both systems and controls and the ending financial balances.
Thank you. I knew there was many, many hours, and when you look at some of the documents and you just see a summary sheet, you know, people might think, oh, there's not much to it, but between the city staff time and your staff time, there's multitudes of hours
big
in
process,
there.
Yes. Yes.
Further questions? Councillor Albrecht?
More of a comment than anything. I just wanted to take this opportunity to thank Darren and the staff for doing a really great job. It's nice to have that comfort that we're being looked after and the finances are being reviewed on a regular and ongoing basis by very capable people. Thank you.
Well, thank you for coming, and again to your team, thank you, and to Darren and his team, thank you. So I now need a City Council approve the 2014 consolidated financial statements. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Arnold, Councillor Stortebrum, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Thank you. And the next item are upcoming meetings. The next regular council meeting is on May 11th, 2015, and that one will be televised. After that, it'll be May 25th, 2015. And those are regular meetings. Metro Vancouver, Councillor Stortebrum.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was privileged to attend a marathon strategic planning session with Metro Vancouver, not this past weekend, but the weekend before. We've got another meeting coming up at the end of this month. You have your brief in your council package, as well as some correspondence in council mail specific to a brand new recycling tool that has been launched by Metro Vancouver, and I would invite the general public and all those who'd be interested in investigating recycling options available for multifamily residential. Simply go to the Metro Vancouver website, and they have a tool there. You can key in that you're from Langley City and the number of units that are in your apartment, and they will be able to assist property owners and strata property managers in determining how best to address some of the recycling associated with the residential multifamily units here in the town, including different signages and types of bins and what have you. And it's all intended to assist multi-family strata and residential units, because it seems that the recycling rate for multifamily is only about 28%, whereas single-family residential is about 60%. So this is an attempt by Metro Vancouver to increase those percentages. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Councillor Hall.
Just to follow that up, so if the city is no longer really in the recycling business, although we have an interest in having a diversion rate from our regular garbage stream to recycling, who monitors the strata's recycling rate? So if we throw out a figure that they're not pulling their weight and they're not doing the same as the single family homes, and the city's not going to monitor that, how does Metro Vancouver, who does monitor the success or lack of success of something like you're offering here, or Metro is offering the toolkit?
Thank you, Councillor Hall, for your question. It's a good question. Metro Vancouver is intending to guesstimate what those recycling rates are. Recycling systems vary between municipalities and individual buildings, so there's no one-size-fits-all solutions. But this is just a toolkit intended to assist in the recycling of those materials in strata based on the estimates provided by Metro Vancouver.
So just supplementary to that. So it's a simulation. So as you say, it's a guesstimate. Like, nobody's
right.
Actually doing it. Canter or holding the collection companies to task to actually report out. Like it's easy to throw out figures like that and say, well, they're not doing the job in the stratus, but maybe they are. Like, who's going to monitor this with some accuracy and going forward? Similarly, in the city, we talked a year and a half ago about our successful introduction to the multi-materials program and how we had a pretty high diversion rate. We at the city, I would assume, are still monitoring on a monthly basis how much we're diverting, and I'm hoping an engineering report happens sometime in the next few months to compare this year's perhaps February rate with the previous year's with the previous year. But getting back to the Stratus, if we're doing that kind of diligence, then who's doing it for the others? And how can we be assured that that's going to happen?
Mr. Baumhoff?
Yes, under the provincial regulation, there's a requirement that MMBC recycle 75%. So they must achieve that percentage, and that is both for all the residential sector. So they're going to be the ones that are held to account through the province, through the regulations. There are some municipalities as well, like there's some that, like the city of Langley, that have opted to hand over all of the recycling collection to MMBC. So we have less involvement in terms of the day-to-day and even statistics and monitoring the actual volumes. Other municipalities have stayed in it, and they are receiving an incentive from MMBC. So I imagine they are still tracking and they still have some involvement in recycling. But you know, the province is largely the one. They've mandated 75%. The MMBC is the industry representative. They need to meet that target. So they'll be monitored. So they will be monitoring multifamily units as well as single family to achieve that percentage.
Supplementary. So if they're monitoring, who will they report out to and through what vehicle? Will that come through a Metro Vancouver report? Or, like, it won't come through us because we're now divorced from the process.
Right.
So if they're monitoring, they need to report out whether they're successful or not and initiate measures to bring about success if they're not. Where does that report come through? We won't see it at this table. Will it come through a meeting that Councillor Stordeboom will attend?
Ultimately, it's to the province. They're accountable to the province, similar to the way the municipalities were through the solid waste management plans. We were accountable to the province to achieve the goals that we set out. Now it's through industry, through MMBC, they're accountable to the province. And they must report, and they'll ultimately be required to, you know, if they don't meet the target, they'll have to come up with solutions and plans to achieve the target. I'm not 100% sure what role the region has in that. I would have to look into that further.
Councillor Martin.
Am I wrong to assume that the transfer stations would not be monitoring what's being brought into their facilities?
They'll be monitoring whatever's been banned, so of the banned substances or the materials, they'll be monitoring that material, yes.
And I also think the companies themselves, they have to monitor too to make sure that they're not getting any items that could contaminate one way or the other. And I mean, I know from my own multifamily unit, I've been told that they will, you know, they're sort of, with the organics recycling, it's a new program for everybody. And it's kind of a 6 month kind of a leeway, which is surely coming to an end. But after that, I think the companies themselves will be doing some monitoring too. They may not be reporting to Metro Vancouver, but there's gonna be monitoring done. They have to do that, so there's no contamination.
Councillor Albright, and then Councillor Stordeboom.
I'm going to change gears here a little bit, and I was noticing in the board and brief that there was talk about the water fees and rentals and the cost of those going up, and it's something that I think that we should be looking at somewhere down the line is maybe in the introduction of a water water barrel program, trying to conserve and collect rainwater and making use of it and trying to save and protect our water resources as well as have people reduce some costs. Thank you.
Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you for your comment, Councillor Albrecht. And yes, with the organics disposal ban that Councillor Martin was kind enough to remind us of, now would be a good time for buildings to look at their recycling situation. And this is an opportunity to encourage all residents and management alike to take advantage of this opportunity with the tool. More information online. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, next item is library happenings with Councillor Martin.
The City of Langley Library Happenings, April 27th to May the 11th. Patients' Rights, the First Step in Advanced Care Planning, Wednesday, April the 29th, 11 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. Registration is appreciated. And they say, did you know that the Canadian Medical Association recommends everyone develop an advanced care plan? Knowing your rights as a patient is an important part of this process. Join Dying with Dignity Canada for an informative program presented about your rights and how you can plan for your future medical care. And again, that's April the 29th, 11 till 12:30, and registration is appreciated. And on Friday, May the 1st, from 10:30 to 11, story time, where you can introduce kids to the love of books and language with story time. Children and caregivers will enjoy interactive stories, songs, rhymes, and more. Story time prepares children to learn to read. And that is the library happenings from April the 27th to May 11th. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. I'd just like to thank Kim Hilton and her staff, especially Tara Adele, for this past weekend. It was pitch-in day on Saturday, and we didn't have as many volunteers out as we thought that we were going to come out, especially around the Bryden Lagoon area. But the Green Party were out in full force with the men in green suits. It was like a hockey game, guys. And they put a lot of time, a lot of effort in, and we collected bags and bags of garbage. And it was quite something to see all the people at work. So there was over 24 people, I believe, involved in this cleanup. And again, could you please thank Tara? She did a lot of hard work. And we picked up some very interesting items out there, so I'm looking forward to next year. So nothing like keeping the city clean. So thank you again, Kim. So the next item we have under bylaws is a bylaw 2889, a zoning bylaw to accommodate 13 townhouse units at 19765 and 19773 55A Avenue, and the motion is final reading of the bylaw cited as a zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, amendment number 116-2012, number 2889. And I mover and seconder, Councillor Hall, Councillor Arnold. All those in favor? It's unanimous 4. The next item is the consideration of development permit number 0912. And the motion is that development permit application DP09-12 to accommodate 13-unit townhouse development at 19765 and 19773-55A Avenue be approved subject to execution of a development servicing agreement in compliance with the conditions outlined in the Director of Development Services and Economic Development Report. Need a mover and a seconder? Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Hall. Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, it's unanimous 4. The next item is the, first, second, and third reading of the bylaw cited as the 2015 tax rates bylaw number 2015, number 2955. And I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Martin, discussion at all? Councillor Hall.
Through the mayor to staff, can you explain to me why it's taken as long as it has to move this forward and what minor adjustments are made here? Thank you.
Certainly. So as part of our financial plan discussions that we have earlier on in the year and passed that bylaw in the beginning of March, What we do is we wait until the assessment authority comes out with their final assessment values, which is what we use to apply the tax rates to. So we are that comes out at the end of that, basically right at this time of the year. So that's why it's coming to you like almost a month later than what we had discussed it earlier on in our financial plan process.
So supplementary to that, so there's been a minor adjustment as noted in your report that's adjusted the ratio to some extent. The business class properties get hit with a little bit more than was anticipated. So is this as a result of assessment appeals, or is this just a difference between actual assessments and what we guess the assessments would be?
No, it doesn't take into account the assessment. I mean, the change between what we thought it was at the completed roll at the end of December and what it is now is definitely because of the assessment appeal process. So this change is reflecting what we thought was going to happen in our financial plan. So it's not anything different, really, than what we already anticipated.
Thank you. I actually had that same question. I was wondering why the bit of a delay, and thank you for clarifying that. So further discussion? Seeing none, I need all those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Next item we have is first and second reading of the bylaw, cited as the financial plan 2014 to 2018, bylaw 2014, number 2931, amendment number 2, bylaw 2956. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Martin, is there a discussion? Councillor Hall?
Through the mayor to staff, could you just suggest what the amendments are? And there's something in there about an environmental reassessment of a property. I'd just like some explanation of why we assume the costs and not the seller of the original property to it.
So there's two pieces to this amendment. One is the operating side, and the one you're referring to is the capital side. So that is a property that the city purchased to put our parks operation building in. And when we purchased that property, we did have an agreement with the vendor of the property, the seller of the property, to do some environmental work. The concern was that our original agreement was for a certain period of time, and some of that environmental remediation took longer than that a time frame, so we had some issues with respect to the timing of when that remediation could take place and resolve it.
Okay, now I understand the context. We had a discussion before on this behind. Yes.
Further discussion? Thank you for clarifying that. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. The next item we have is the committee reports, Recreation, Culture, and Public Art Advisory Committee report on painted garbage can. And Councillor Storteboom, would you like to speak on this?
I'm going to defer to Kim Hilton, if I may. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Worship. At our, I think it was our February RCPAC meeting, a young lady from RE Mountain Secondary came to our committee and presented a fundraising opportunity that she was doing as part of her recreational leadership program at RE Mountain. That fundraising program includes clothes drive towards Big Brothers of Greater Vancouver, and it's running May 11th to the 15th. And in conclusion of that fundraiser, her class would like to paint a garbage can as a legacy and leave it within one of the parks in the city. So the motion before you is the one that the committee came up with.
I'd like to make that motion.
Seconded by Councillor Arnold. Is there a discussion on this at all? Seeing none, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item we have is from Parks Environment Advisory Committee report, the naming of the city's dog park. And Councillor Hall, would you care to speak on this item?
You have received the report. A little bit background history. Council sent the Peak Committee on a mission to discuss the issue of whether a name was necessary for the dog park or whether it might stay the same after bandying about for a couple of meetings. They came up with a whole bunch of possible names. The rationale for coming up with a new name rather than doing nothing was largely that we now have two parks, wanted to be some distinction between the two, and there were some safety concerns raised. They had a number of interesting and creative submissions, including ones that didn't make the cut, like Central Bark, S-C-E-N-T-R-A-L, Bark, Central Bark. Happy Tails Dog Park did make the cut. Freedom to Run Dog Park did not. There was some thought about naming it geographically after Uplands or the Mossy Estates neighborhood. There was some discussion about whether commercial sponsorship and a naming should be applied, and the thinking was that we would really like to continue to recognize the commercial sponsorship of the bag program and the donation of the trees by Applewood Kia, but to name the entire park in a commercial manner like that was thought not to be the best option. So the recommendation that you have before you is that the Environment Advisory Committee is submitting four potential names for your consideration. Uplands Dog Park, Happy Tails Dog Park, Dogwood Park, and Pleasantdale Dog Park, Pleasantdale being the creek that runs from that. I would assume that we're simply receiving these recommendations for information, and then motion should be perhaps forthcoming from council as to a choice or a non-choice, if right. That's the prerogative of council. I'd be happy to deliver what I believe is the best of the four, but I'll leave that until after we've received the committee recommendation.
Okay, receive. I need a mover to receive the first whereas, second whereas, and the committee names. Councillor Hall, and seconded by Councillor Storteboom. All those in favor of receiving? That's unanimous four. And Councillor Hall?
Let the drums roll. Yes. There's four recommended names. I would suggest that we really should move on one of them, and I'm going to put forward, if I can get a seconder, I'm going to put forward the name Dogwood Park, and I'm hoping for a seconder, and I'll speak to that.
Seconder?
Sure.
Councillor Albrecht and Councillor Hall?
Well, speaking to that, it came out of the discussions of committee, and it's a nice play on words to start with, Dogwood Park. The potential here, though, too, is in embracing that moving forward. This is potentially our own arboretum, and the suggestion is that we could in treeing this, what used to be a wasteland in the hydro cut, we could have a theme, and dogwoods, the symbol of British Columbia, could be added. Certainly. I would suggest that having a name for the park gives it an identity rather than simply calling it Langley City Dog Park Number 1 or the very confusing Brookswood Dog Park, which confuses it with Brookswood Park, which is in the township, and Brookswood as a neighborhood. So I favor a name, and I like this one, and it was a staff suggestion that came through committee, and I very much would like to embrace that. Thank you.
Is there some further discussion on this? Councillor Storteboom?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for your recommendation, Councillor Hall. I can appreciate that there's some levity in naming a dog park, but I think it's important, at least from my perspective, that it be identified as a City of Langley Park rather than being confused with a township of Langley Park, because it is right on the border. I can appreciate the dogwood representing our great province of British Columbia, and a potential theme throughout the entire length of that hydro right-of-way, but I'm sorry, I'm not as inspired as you about that name. Please excuse me, and thank you.
Councillor Martin, and then Councillor Albrecht.
Thank you. Well, if the emergency responders are confused about finding the dog park now, I think they're going to be more confused when it's if it's named Dogwood Park. I'm not in favor of naming it at all. I think that no matter what it's named, if it's named, it's going to be called up at the dog park in Brookswood. That's going to be the name. If I had a choice of these four names, I would call it the Uplands Dog Park, because that's exactly where the dog park is in the Uplands neighborhood. At least the fire trucks and the police could go around, run around that neighborhood until they find a dog park. They'll know they're in the Upland area. But Dogwood Park, I would not vote in favor of that. And I'm not, like I say, I don't think changing the name at all is necessary. So I will not be supporting the Dogwood Park name.
Councillor Albrecht.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And thanks, Councillor Hall, for the explanation on the chosen name, Dogwood. I can't. I'm somewhat like Councillor Storteboom. I'm not necessarily inspired by the name Dogwood. And in fact, I would probably be more inclined with the Uplands Dog Park, like Councillor Martin has stated. But I did want to acknowledge your involvement on the committee, as well as the committee's work in doing this research and putting this information together. I guess it's nice to have something that's historical and means something to the city, rather than just the Brookswood Park that kind of counters the logic of it being a city-owned park. So I guess I won't be supporting the Dogwood name at this point. Thank you.
For myself, I like the name Uplands Dog Park. It states where it's at in the area, and it adds something to one of the six neighborhoods that we have, and we're trying to promote the neighborhoods. And I give my council colleague lots of credit for taking this task on and taking it to the committee, and to the committee for coming up with all these names. Some were quite interesting to look at, and the freedom to run. Well, yeah, they're running all right, and it's great. I'm looking forward to the second dog off-leash park. And but again, my personal choice is Uplands Dog Park, and I think that the park should have a name, just like we have Linwood Park, Iris Mooney Park, or any other park out there. And I'm sure Rory and his gang know where the Linwood Park is, or Condor Park. So once they get entrenched to one or two incidences or having some fun, they'll find it pretty quick. So I have Councillor Arnold, and then Councillor Martin again.
Yeah, I think our fire department will be able to find a dog park. Matter of fact, if I'm in a city and I'm looking for something and I don't know where it is, I go ask the fire department. They always seem to know where everything is, and I would hope it's that way. I also, I guess, I'm going to be on the losing end of this whole thing, because I'm the only one that would like to see it named after the trail that runs right into it. But I certainly don't support the current motion, so I'll be voting against that as well.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you. I guess just to clarify, I mean, there's been talk about, you know, the city, the township, and what have you. And for those that have been up to the dog park, I'm sure many have, there is a 6-foot sign that says City of Langley Dog Park. I mean, it's quite obvious that it is a dog park, and it's quite obvious it's the City of Langley. So that's why I don't think we have to rename it. But may I ask the staff that if we did name it, and let's just say we're going to call it the Uplands Dog Park, can Uplands just be added to the sign instead of the whole sign having to be redone again? Because, I mean, there's costs involved in this stuff. And like I say, I don't think it's necessary, but it's even more unnecessary to spend money on upgrading the sign if we don't have to. Could we just add Uplands to it if that's the name that is ever chosen, or if a name is chosen?
Mr. Bumpa?
We could add I would need to look at how much space is left on the sign. Yeah. Like, we have done that with other signs. Depends on how it would look, but I think we want to advertise this quite well as well, that people do recognize that it is a name change.
So along with changing the name, then we got to spend money on advertising this. I mean, like, before we do this, can we have some kind of a budget of what this would cost us? I mean, I don't think we should just arbitrarily say, change the name, and then find out it's going to cost us $5,000 or $10,000. So could I defer this decision until we get some kind of a budget on what it would cost if the name were changed?
To staff? Councillor Martin would like to defer this to get some cost implications on this.
Council can make a motion to postpone, make a decision.
So I will move to postpone this motion to get further
get the cost
and clarification
to remain,
as to what it takes.
Sign.
Yeah.
Okay, on the motion to defer discussion, all those in favor?
What are we voting on?
Deferral?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So against deferring? Councillor Hall? I'm against deferring it as well. So it goes back to the main motion. So I'll call the question on the main motion then.
The main motion being Dogwood Park.
Dogwood Park. All those in favor of that one? Councillor Hall against? Just Councillor Hall was for. Okay, anything further on this one? Okay. I'll leave it for a follow-up. I'd like to see it named, but another day. Okie dokie.
Question of clarification?
Yes, sir.
When I convey this back to the committee, does the committee have any role to play at this point? Any further role? I would assume not. They've made their recommendations. And
they made their recommendation. It'll come back to council, and hopefully out of the three names, somebody will make a recommendation.
Well, potentially at an ensuing meeting.
Council meeting.
Someone could bring forward a new motion.
Right.
Or another name, or to do nothing, or to refer it to staff or whatever. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, we could put it to rest if I make the motion to call it Uplands Dog Park, and I'll make that motion myself, and if I get a seconder? Well, seeing none?
Yeah, I'll second.
Second it by Councillor Albrecht. Is there a discussion on it at all? Councillor Hall?
It's the longest debate we've had on something that really I didn't think was going to take this long. There's 2,500 people buried in Nepal, and we're talking about dog parks for 20 minutes. But the only reluctance I have with the name Uplands is that Uplands Drive is on the other side of 208, and people get confused as to where Uplands Drive is and where Uplands is. And the identity, maybe there's a bit of a problem there. I don't have a problem with the name Uplands Dog Park, but Mossy Estates would be as good a choice because that's the neighborhood as well. And but tied to the school and the neighborhood meeting we had the other day, it would have been interesting to ask the residents whether they would like to have that name that way. So I'll support that.
Further discussion? Okay. All those in favor of the Uplands Dog Park? Against? Councillor Martin and Councillor Storteboom. And it was four. It was Arnold, Albrecht, Schaefer, and Hall. Thank you. Councillor Martin.
I would still like a report on the cost of having to do this and where that money's coming from.
Mr. Chung could give us some information down the road.
Yeah, we can provide that information to council.
Thank you. So the next item we have is the motion under motions and notice of motion request Fraser Valley Regional Library Board to consider an amnesty day for City of Langley Library. And Councillor Martin, would you like to make the motion?
Yes, I would. I just got to scroll through here until I get to the page. Thank you very much. Going through all these financial reports. Yes, I would like to move that a letter be sent to the Fraser Valley Regional Library Acting Board Chair Helen Fathers to request that the Fraser Valley Regional Library Board add an item titled Amnesty Day for the City of Langley Library to their May agenda for consideration. And if it's seconded, I'd like to speak to it.
Councillor Storyman.
May I?
Yes. Councillor Martin.
Yeah. I would also like to suggest that when we write a letter that we suggest that it could be a fresh start for the people in our library, and it will create goodwill, and it'll also tie nicely into our fresh new renovation, you know, for people to come and have a look at it. But I just got a few more facts. I was in touch with the library manager today, and Langley Library currently has about 5,300 items that are checked out and overdue at an approximate value of $140,000. And during amnesty, fines for the currently books that are checked out are forgiven. The fines are forgiven, but if you do return a book and it's damaged, there would be fees. And if you do come in without a book, you gotta pay for the replacement cost. And actually, when Maple Ridge, Mission, and Delta held an amnesty day, the library received more money than what was waived. So it's quite interesting. So I kind of think that the board will go for this. Paul and I did attend a two-day library planning session last week, and I mentioned it to the corporate secretary, and she said Maple Ridge is sort of throwing out that we have a challenge between all the libraries for an amnesty day to see who can get the most books back. So we'll that'll be discussed at the May board meeting if this meeting passes. But I think it's a really good idea to have a challenge amongst all the libraries to see who can get the most. But $140,000, nothing to sneeze at in books. So that's all I have to say on that. Hopefully the motion will carry. Thank you.
Councillor Arnold.
Well, particularly if it's a challenge between the various local libraries, what happens if someone here in Langley happens to have a book that they took out over in Maple Ridge? Can they bring it back here?
Yes, you can return. We belong to Interlink, so you can actually return the books to any library in the Lower Mainland, but certainly Maple Ridge is part of the Fraser Valley Library system, so they can return it to Maple Ridge.
But that would then count as part of the amnesty here?
Come to us, yeah. It okay. Should count for, I'm not sure of the details, but I would think it would. Thank you.
Councillor Hall and then Councillor Albrecht.
So I'm in full support of this, but in that we're requesting from the Fraser Valley Regional Library permission to do this or the go-ahead to do this, I'm just wondering why would we narrow it down to a single day? If I'm a person that's had these books for a long period of time and I am feeling guilty in, but I can't get there on one particular day, then I'm kind of off. So I realize now we're in the spirit of competition. You got to have a level playing field, but I would hope that every place might have 1 to 3 days or something like that. So if on a particular day you can't make it. So a minor amendment I propose is to just add after day, bracket, S, bracket. And they can advise us. If they'll only go for 1 day, that's fine. If they'll give us 1 to 3 or 1 to 5 or something like that, then I'd very much like that to happen. So I'll propose that amendment.
Is that seconded? Okay, I'll call the question on the amendment. On the amendment to add the S. All those in favor?
No, commenting. Oh. She's commenting.
Oh.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that, but I would certainly be willing to bring that up without amending this, bring that up and see sort of what the norm is at, or what the norm has been. As a matter of fact, Councillor Hall, I was thinking today that, you know, say we had a Saturday. The library, I think, is only open till 5 on Saturdays. And, you know, you'd want a day, Saturday would have to be one of the days for the people that don't work. But then it would also be nice to have a day where we're open till 9 o'clock at night, too. So, you know, those things. I'd be happy to bring that up at the board meeting in May without doing any kind of an adjustment on the motion. That's okay with you?
To Carolyn, can that be a friendly amendment adding the S, or does it need a motion?
Yeah, no, an amendment that minor would be a friendly amendment.
Okay. Would you be agreeable
to that? If the mover was in support.
I don't think it's necessary because I could bring it up.
Okay.
I mean, I'd be happy to see 2 or 3 days.
Okay.
Back,
so, Councillor Hall will just pull that.
Speaking to the amendment, then. I just think if we're writing a letter, we might as well put it in writing, and then it, you know, I realize you'll bring it up, but at least there's something there that other people, having read it, going to the meeting, perhaps would consider multiple days. So,
question on the amendment? Yes, then. All those in favor? Against? Okay. Now on the main amendment, Councillor Martin, do you want anything, or do you want to call the question on this? Councillor Storyboom.
Well, thank you very much. There's a lot of variables associated with this from my perspective. I trust you have thought this through, and from your experience with library board that this works. It just seems kind of odd. You say that when there's a general amnesty for books that they actually make more money than the fines that they forgive. How does that work?
Councillor Martin?
Well, I guess people that come in with their book, and instead of saying, I won't pay the fines. I owe the fines, so I'll pay it, you know.
Oh.
Which they can do,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah. And likewise, they can just drop off
They can just
book
drop off the
night
book also. Yeah.
Too,
yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I trust your judgment on this, Councilor Martin. Thank you.
Call the question.
I was just going to suggest.
Go ahead.
You know, on, and I know the amendment, but I had my hand up. You passed
yep.
it. And, that would be amnesty day or days for the city of Langley.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
So that can be a friendly amendment.
Yeah. Okay. That would be a friendly amendment.
Councillor Albrecht.
I just feel compelled because I'm on the library board. I think it's really important that we get these valuable resources back into these facilities so that they can get back out in circulation and earning revenue and educating people. So I'm fully supportive.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing this to our attention, Councillor Martin. So call the question. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. And those in the audience that wondered where 7A was earlier, we moved it in behind Mr. Cox, so it was it dovetailed in right behind them. So the next items we have are under Councillor Hall.
We won't have another council meeting before the LMLGA, and the city has 4 significant resolutions going to that. So we received a memo that suggested that the draft of all of the resolutions, 16 pages worth, has been sent to us, but the executive will not deal with these, and we will not know whether they have approved or not until the day that we arrive. And so I wanted to ask a question of staff through the mayor of clarification of how the executive of LMLGA deals with these. What background information do they gather? Do they seek out addition to what was submitted, or do they simply take what was submitted? And I guess I'm questioning why there's such a late arrival of the executive recommendations or approvals or not, because that carries a lot of weight when the executive who I guess we would trust to make wise decisions, but remember they're not an elected body. There's little accountability, but they do run the organization. I would hope that in the future we would get their recommendation earlier. So I'm just a little bit of clarification, then I just want to dovetail on it just to highlight some of the initiatives that other regions are putting forward so that the general public realizes what's happening at this conference.
I'll ask staff, Ms. Machado.
Through Mayor Schaefer to Councillor Hall. Just a point of clarification, I do believe that the board members are elected members through the LMLGA when the that conference meets, there's usually an election of those board members.
Clarification, they're not publicly elected, they're elected by members of the association, which is a considerably different accountability than a public process.
So then, Ms. Machado, was there information then?
I couldn't speak to why it takes so long, but the only thing that they do indicate in their resolution process is that they're looking for resolutions with provincial interest, and those are the ones that are forwarded to UBCM. I would also note that this is the same process that takes place for UBCM and FCM, although they don't typically release the motions on the day of, first day of the convention.
Councillor Hall.
Thank you. All right. So I just want to highlight. So as I said, the city has four resolutions, one of which is a very important one, asking the provincial government to adopt a homelessness strategy, which was delivered by Councillor Martin to this table and is moving on. We have three others. There's a package of homelessness items. Resolutions, some of them asking that the federal government take responsibility, and this one asking that the province. So it's a very important debate because somebody has to take ownership of that. As well, Coquitlam has a resolution that's asking for more accountability from regional representatives to Metro and whatnot. They're asking that what happens in other jurisdictions in terms of whether people are elected or whether they're appointed by municipal councils, as is the practice here. Richmond and Delta both have initiatives that are asking that Port Metro Vancouver be more accountable for one, erosion of the ALR, and two, environmental assessments that are on a larger geographical area than simply the footprint of what's being built. For example, the Terminal 2 project of Roberts Bank Corridor. There's an expiry of the federal cooperative housing agreement. And see, here's one that all of a sudden you encounter at a convention. You're told 5 days ahead of time that an agreement with the federal government is about to lapse. And another locale has put forward a resolution suggesting that, well, we got to make sure that that cooperative housing initiative is maintained, yet we don't have any background information at all on that. So through the mayor to staff, before I get there, I would like to be brief on what's entailed in that federal housing initiative in support of cooperative housing, something that is an option that we perhaps should be pursuing. We don't have a cooperative housing unit here, although the township has a shining example that was built many years ago and has not necessarily expanded. But certainly, if the agreement disappears, we're not going to have any opportunity for that. So I'd like to have that information. As I said, there's 16 pages worth of resolutions, and certainly this will be a valuable debate once we get there. Thank you.
To staff, then, Councillor Hall is requesting a little bit of info, so before he or anyone else goes, that you could get a little bit of background information and just put it in the box.
Just to clarify, just for that one?
And those that have an interest could give you a call if they need a little bit more background.
Okay.
And we'll start with that one.
Yeah, we'll search, contact the host community who put forward that resolution and see if we can get a copy of their report.
Thank you, Mr. Chung. Further to that, the next items we have is some correspondence. Operation Lifesaver, Public Rail Safety Week, April 27th to May 3rd, 2015. And the Elizabeth Fry Society of Greater Vancouver, Elizabeth Fry Week, May 3rd to May 9th, 2015. And any new business? Councilor Martin?
I brought it up the last time. Again, just a reminder to send in your plebiscite envelope for the TransLink plebiscite. right as of yesterday, Langley Township was leading with, I think, 21.8% response. Never heard the city of Langley mentioned, but Langley Township is leading the way right now. So let's get the city of Langley in there and send in your votes. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. And motion to adjourn. Starterbroom, Albrecht. All those in favor? It's unanimous. So thank you for joining us this evening, and we'll see you in a couple weeks.